This is the second part of the anatomy of larynx. Just a quick refreshing of what we mentioned in the first part. As you see, this is arytenoid cartilage, okay, on each side. This is cricoid cartilage. This is the posterior aspect. This muscle between the two arytenoids is what? Transverse arytenoid. What do you think is the function? Is going to be adduction of the vocal cord, because when you contract this muscle, you bring this close to that, and as you know, from the front of this cartilage, vocal cord extend to the back of thyroid cartilage. Then what is this muscle? This is posterior cricoarytenoid muscle. What is the important aspect of this muscle? This is the only abductor. This is abductor of vocal cord. Of vocal cord. Okay. Here is again transverse and the posterior cricoarytenoid. And this is if you wanted to cover this muscle with another muscle from back, is going to be what? Oblique arytenoid. The oblique arytenoid extend up to the epiglottis as aryepiglottic. Aryepiglottic. And this is the laryngeal cavity. So basically, contraction of aryepiglottic shut down this cavity during swallowing. Okay. Okay, so this is the inside of the larynx. If we take section inside the larynx, we can divide the larynx into three parts from inside. The inlet, which extend from the epiglottis down to the vestibular fold. This is the vestibular fold. And then you have the ventricle between vestibular fold and vocal cord. Okay. So this narrow space is called the ventricle, and as you see, it extends laterally to form another space which is called saccule. Okay, then the third part is the outlet, and the outlet is infraglottic part here, take you to the trachea, extend from the vocal cord down to the trachea, Okay, but if you return this to normal, like because you cut the larynx from the back, like this, like what we did with the pharynx, and then you open it, you see the right and left side. This is the right side, okay, and this is left side. So basically, when you look here, you find the two fold, the vestibular fold and the vocal fold. If you return everything back to normal, you create a space between the two vocal cords. This is the narrowest area of the larynx. We call it rima glottidis. So the space between the two vocal cords, here is one and here is another one, right? And the left vocal cord represented by the two pen. So we have narrow space. This is the narrowest part of the airway. It's called the rima glottidis. Okay. So this is how larynx look like from inside. Then if you look with endoscopy, this is during normal breathing. This is the epiglottis, okay? This is the epiglottis, and this is the inlet. And this elevation represents the vestibular fold, this one, vestibular fold. Then down here is vocal cord, the vocal cord. And the between inverted V-shaped space, this is the rima glottidis between the two vocal cords. Okay. This is the narrow part of the airway. And this is during the breathing, because both of them are abducted. And during deep breathing, even getting larger. Okay. Then during speaking, there is sort of adduction. As you see, the two vocal cords very close to each other. There is very narrow space in between. If you want to cough or sneeze or there is straining, there is shutdown of everything and holding the air into the trachea, and this is even approximating the two vestibular fold together. Not only complete shutdown here of the vocal cord, but also vestibular fold might approximate to each other. Okay. So this is another view, again, just to repeat what we just mentioned. This is the epiglottis here, And number two is vestibular, number one is vocal cord. And here is, what do you think this is? Is it breathing or speaking? So this is during speaking, because the two vocal cords are very close to each other. And here is nice demonstration for arytenoid. This is vocal process. This is arytenoid, this is a back, and this is thyroid cartilage, and here is the vocal cord, and another vocal cord on the other side. So this space between both, between these two cords are what? Rima glottidis, the rima glottidis. And rima glottidis, most of the space located between the two vocal cords, that's why we call it intercartilage, or interligamental or membranous. This is the anterior three-fifths. And the posterior two-fifths between the vocal processes of arytenoid, we call it intercartilaginous. I'm sorry if I scratched this. It was correct. Intercartilaginous. This is the posterior two-fifths of rima glottidis. So the rima glottidis, again, is the space between the two vocal cords. And the anterior three-fifths between the two vocal cords, the posterior two-fifths between the arytenoid cartilage. And this is even better view when you see cricoid cartilage extend this conus elasticus or cricovocal ligament, and the upper border create the vocal cord. So this one is cricovocal ligament or conus elasticus, and the upper border become thick. And keep in mind that vocal cord, okay, vocalis muscle, which is part of thyroarytenoid muscle, represent the bulk of vocal cord. And it is important in speaking because it changes the shape of vocal cord during speaking. During the phonation process, vocalis muscle, which is part of thyroarytenoid muscle. Okay, closure of the larynx. This is summarized. When we close the larynx, when do we close the larynx? How about closure of the inlet during swallowing? During swallowing, which muscle important here? Epiglottic muscle. This is very important to us. Closure of the vestibular fold. This is during cough or straining in general to increase the intrathoracic tension. Holding air in trachea. When we close vocal cord during phonation, what are muscles important in closing the vocal cord? You have transverse arytenoid. You have lateral crico arytenoid. Okay. Those are important two muscles, and the oblique, of course. Cricothyroid play some role also. So if you look here, this is the vocal cord approximating to each other. This is during speaking, and this is opening, and here is the two wide cords. Again, this is closed the larynx, but this is open one during breathing. So now I think this is good refresh for you to remember the function of muscles. Now let us go to important thing, nerve supply of larynx. The nerve supply of larynx, you need to understand something. Here is the vagus. This is jugular foramen. And vagus coming through jugular foramen. Correct? This is jugular foramen in the base of the skull. And you have two ganglia. The upper one and lower one. Before getting into carotid sheath. This is carotid sheath. So these two ganglia, The upper one give two branches, meningeal and the auricular branch. The lower one give laryngeal branch, laryngeal and the pharyngeal branches. So keep in mind that the laryngeal here is superior laryngeal nerve, okay, this one, you see, superior laryngeal nerve coming from the inferior ganglion of the vagus, which we call it ganglion nodosum, and split into two branches. This branch is called the internal, and it is the sensory penetrating the thyroid membrane. And this branch, which descend down over the inferior constrictor to reach to cricothyroid muscle. This is external laryngeal. So this is the external laryngeal, and this one is internal laryngeal nerve, superior internal. So here is a superior divided into internal and external. External laryngeal, internal laryngeal. What is the function of internal laryngeal nerve? The internal laryngeal nerve is purely sensory, carry general sensation from larynx above vocal cord, yeah? It means upper half of the larynx. In addition, taste sensation from epiglottis and the tongue. So carrying taste sensation from epiglottis and the tongue, and most posterior part of the tongue, and also general sensation from the most posterior part of the tongue. So basically, it has both sensation, general, which represent the touch, pain, temperature, and the taste sensation. The external laryngeal nerve supply one muscle, as you see, the cricothyroid muscle, which is important for phonation because it produces tension over the vocal cord to change the tone of the voice. Okay, so this is again nice demonstration. This is what superior laryngeal, external laryngeal nerve, and this is internal laryngeal nerve. Okay, the artery which you go side by side with the the artery which is going side by side here is going to be superior thyroid artery, and here superior laryngeal artery. So what is next? You have vagus continuous through carotid sheath, correct? Then in both sides, vagus will send recurrent laryngeal nerve, this one. In the right side, it's around subclavian artery. That's why it come at higher level here and ascend. See, this is recurrent laryngeal nerve, right one. In the left side, coming from mediastinum, this is the sternum. See, and it extend down to the arch of aorta, then ascend from down here from the mediastinum. Why? Why it is coming down here? Because ligamentum arteriosus hold the vagus down in the mediastinum. But in the right side, there is no ligamentum arteriosus. There is no ligamentum arteriosus, correct? Which used to be ductus arteriosus. But in the left side is the one which keep the vagus down here and the recurrent laryngeal in the left side coming from lower level. The recurrent laryngeal nerve, what is the function of recurrent laryngeal nerve? Recurrent laryngeal nerve, and here it is on this side, is beautiful. As you see, and this is, you look from the back, that's why this is going to be the right side, and this is the left side. In the left side here is coming from the thorax around the arch of aorta, in the left side subclavian, in the right side subclavian artery. So this is right, this is left. And here is a recurrent laryngeal nerve ascend back of thyroid gland. Here is thyroid gland, this one. And you notice something. The artery which come close to the nerve at the thyroid gland is the inferior thyroid and the inferior laryngeal artery coming from thyrocervical trunk. So this is inferior thyroid and inferior laryngeal arteries. And this is important relation, because during thyroidectomy, Okay, you need to ligate the artery to prevent significant bleeding. So where is the good place to ligate inferior thyroid artery? Is it close to the gland or away from the gland? Of course, from this scene, from this picture, away from the gland. Why? To avoid ligating the recurrent laryngeal nerve with that. So here, very close, but here is far from each other. So this is where you ligate the artery, away from the gland. Okay? However, thyroid arteries, the superior thyroid artery, is descending next to the nerve. Like, let us say that this green color is the artery. The green color here is the artery. Then is going to separate from the nerve, from external laryngeal nerve close to the gland. So if you want to ligate the artery, superior thyroid artery, you ligate it close to the gland, but inferior thyroid away from the gland. Why? Because superior thyroid is very close to external laryngeal nerve at the beginning, then they separate from each other later. Again, let us like test ourselves. So which nerve number one? This is what? Superior laryngeal nerve, correct. Which nerve number two? Internal laryngeal nerve. Which nerve number three? External laryngeal nerve. So you can test yourself what is the function of this sensation above the vocal cord, and test the sensation and general sensation from the most posterior part of the tongue and the epiglottis. External laryngeal nerve, supply cricothyroid muscle, correct? Then here is recurrent laryngeal nerve. Function of recurrent laryngeal nerve, the function of recurrent laryngeal nerve. All laryngeal muscles except the intrinsic laryngeal, except what? Cricothyroid. And also sensation, general sensation from lower half. Lower half of larynx. So this is the function. When I say recurrent laryngeal nerve supply all laryngeal muscle, this include what? The most important muscles, which is posterior cricoarytenoid. The only abductor. That's why injury, if there is damage to recurrent laryngeal nerve, there will be immediate adduction of the vocal cord by cricothyroid muscle, which will become unopposed. It will be adducted, coming close to the midline. If it happens on both sides, it will be disaster, because it means shutting down the airway. How about blood supply? Blood supply is very simple, straightforward. So here is arterial, and here is venous drainage. The arteries coming from thyroid, you have superior thyroid artery giving superior laryngeal, going to the larynx with internal laryngeal nerve here through thyroid membrane. You have inferior thyroid artery is going to give inferior laryngeal and going to the larynx, supplying the lower part of the larynx. So you have superior thyroid and inferior thyroid. Veins, the same, they follow the arteries. You have inferior laryngeal vein going to superior thyroid vein back to the internal jugular. So this is internal jugular vein. You have superior thyroid receiving from upper part of larynx, inferior thyroid from lower part of pharynx, and also superior thyroid vein. Because keep in mind that we have three thyroid veins here, superior, middle, inferior, but in the arteries we have only superior and inferior thyroid arteries. Here is the inferior thyroid vein going to the pricocephalic. This is middle thyroid veins going to internal jugular. Superior thyroid veins going to internal jugular. Okay? So basically, thyroid veins and the arteries are responsible for supplying larynx, arterial supply and venous drainage. Finally, let us come here again to emphasize two things before going into the detail of the nerve injury. Okay, here is a relation between laryngeal nerves and thyroid arteries during the thyroidectomy. You need to pay attention to that. Again, I am emphasizing it. So, as you see, this is superior thyroid artery And at the beginning, it is accompanied by this nerve, external laryngeal nerve, then they separate close to the gland, separating. So if you want to ligate the superior thyroid artery, ligate it here, close to the gland. On the other hand, here is the inferior thyroid artery. You see the inferior thyroid artery is too far from recurrent laryngeal nerve at the beginning. Here is the yellow one. The yellow one is recurrent laryngeal nerve. But they come closer when to each other, close to the gland. So basically, if you want to ligate the artery, you ligate the artery away from the gland. So inferior thyroid away, superior thyroid close to the gland. And now the relation. However, there is usually variation in the relation. Like here is, this is superior thyroid artery, and this is external laryngeal nerve. Superior thyroid artery, and this one external laryngeal nerve. This is a common relation where both of them become far from each other, close to the gland. Okay, so the artery, you like get it here, close to the gland. However, there is some variation where they can come close to each other all the way down, and they become very dangerous, and you need to pay attention. Okay, and then here is another variation where become again like is close at the beginning but little distance between both, close to the gland. So there is always variation. Okay, but the most common thing is a good thing, that it's a clear cut, they are separating from each other close to the gland. Okay. Now, effect of injury of laryngeal nerve, paralysis of laryngeal muscle, and the effect of injury. Let us agree for some terms first before talking about the effect of injury. Paralysis of laryngeal muscle, it should affect phonation, it should affect inspiration, and also it should affect like holding and straining if it is like devastating things. So basically, this is under normal condition. Under normal condition, this is the right and the left vocal cord. They are like close to each other, but there is a space between both. This is during, this is what we call it adduction, and during phonation. This is during phonation. They are very close to each other. This is during respiration, inverted V shape. They are away from each other. This is what we call it abduction. Then during expiration, midway. During expiration, there is adduction, but small gap. A small gap. What would happen if there is complete or incomplete? In complete paralysis, keep in mind this fact, equal to injury of recurrent laryngeal nerve. Complete paralysis equal injury of recurrent laryngeal nerve plus external laryngeal nerve. Plus external laryngeal nerve. On complete paralysis, which injury of recurrent laryngeal nerve, it means that you lose the function of which muscle? Posterior cricoarytenoid. You keep always link posterior cricoarytenoid to recurrent laryngeal nerve. Posterior cricoarytenoid muscle. CA muscle. Cricoarytenoid. Posterior cricoarytenoid. So let us see what would happen if there is incomplete paralysis and unilateral. What would happen for phonation? What would happen for respiration? Okay, this is phonation. Let us keep remembering. This, the upper part is phonation. Okay. What would happen here? Incomplete unilateral in the right side here. What would happen? Posterior cricoarytenoid is paralyzed. So there will be adduction because it's unopposed. Does this will affect, this is affect, will this affect the phonation? Of course, no, not too much, because during phonation you need adduction anyway. So there is no effect on phonation if there is unilateral paralysis of recurrent laryngeal nerve, because posterior cricoarytenoid, which is abductor, paralyzed, so there is adduction and approximation to the midline, and this is what you need for phonation. Okay, if there is unilateral paralysis of recurrent laryngeal nerve, what would happen for respiration? Here again, because unopposed abductor, this will be adducted. And instead of having inverted V shape, this is now become almost parallel, and there is some narrowing of the airway. This is abducted, which is okay. This is what needed during inspiration, but this has come close. There is again no much effect on respiration because the airway is still like there is no significant narrowing, but at least you need to know that the effect that this is will come close to the midline. How about if there is complete paralysis? Complete paralysis. It means paralysis of recurrent and external laryngeal nerve. And it's unilateral in the right side here. If there is paralysis in the right side to both recurrent and external, it means that there is no adduction or abduction and the cord become midway between abduction and adduction. Here is that's why it is shifted laterally, okay, and it become midway between both. There will be compensation during phonation. You will find that this one, the right one, the left one is going to cross the midline, and the still phonation still might be normal. There will be, of course, because of the cricothyroid muscle will be affected, there is hoarseness. There will be some hoarseness of voice, but there will be gradual compensation from the other side, as you see. So basically, because in complete paralysis, the vocal cord will be midway between adduction and abduction. For respiration, trying to open. So because you lose abduction and the adduction, the vocal cord become halfway, and the airway will not be that much affected. Okay. However, during inspiration. However, if it's incomplete and bilateral paralysis, this is where you can find some major issue. Incomplete and bilateral. Bilateral, it means you lost abduction on both sides. When you lose abduction on both sides, it means both vocal cords become adducted. Bilateral adduction. It means you shut down the airway. That's why during respiration, there will be problem. Respiratory distress. You try to have airway passing through, the opening is shut down because both of them coming to the midline. So there will be respiratory distress. Okay, guys? So this is when you have bilateral paralysis of recurrent laryngeal nerve. It means you lose bilateral paralysis of posterior cricoarytenoid muscle, leading to bilateral. So posterior cricoarytenoid muscle, the posterior one is bilateral paralyzed, leading to bilateral adduction. Okay, closure of rima glottidis, which is the airway. You see this red color? It means on both sides you have paralysis and getting the close to each other. Okay, of course, cricothyroid is still working, and the phonation is still, there is some hoarseness, but still the vocal cord can be tensed. I hope that this is help. And before I leave you, just summarize that larynx play important role in swallowing, in phonation, and in respiration. And there is reflex closure of the pharynx during swallowing using airy epiglottic muscle and the oblique muscles. There is closure of the vocal cord during phonation. There is abduction of the vocal cord during respiration. And the relation between laryngeal nerve and thyroid arteries are important for the fact during like thyroidectomy, and to pay attention. You like get superior thyroid close to the gland, but inferior thyroid away of the gland, to avoid injury of external laryngeal and recurrent laryngeal respectively. One other thing, usually laryngeal edema affecting the upper part of the larynx because the mucosa is loosely attached to submucous layer and there is a space where the fluid can accumulate. However, below this level, like below the level of vocal of vestibular fold, there is tight connection or tight adhesion between the mucosa and the underlying layer. That's why the edema usually most of the time is supraglottic above the glottis. Thank you very much, and I hope that this is helpful. And feel free to email me or write a comment or any question, and I will be happy to answer it. Thank you very much.